kukabila ndio kwao. Hapo shafika kweli na hakika, kadiri na shika fura kwa lahiki. Kwa kwa shabiki, raji kuziki, beef na fiki, hit na dhiki. Muda muna wiki, mimi na himzi. Split ni mukiku, doctor sika. Kwa makini mfulisa, mchima la sili. Feel me, feel me.
Title or the topic that I've chosen for these few minutes, and I'm so happy that you would give me a few moments of your time because you are so busy, or really you don't care about what I have to say, really. But you say, well, I don't have nothing else to do, I'll listen to this guy, you know, whatever. I thank you very much for your time today. I want to begin our talk. The title is Black Women Are Valuable as Gold, or Black Women Are a Gold Mine. Now, of course, you have some black males, I can't say man or men, you have black males who would, of course, get very upset and do not agree with such a title. And I want to use them first before I make my commentary, really. I want to speak about some of these corny guys. You are just so pathetic, and y'all a bunch of losers. These guys called black women bashers, y'all a bunch. For real, y'all a bunch of losers. Have you noticed this about these black male, black women bashers? This is what I've noticed. Sometimes they will tell you that I finally got a girlfriend, I finally got married. But usually, most of these guys that bash black women, most of them are lonely. They don't have girlfriends, and that's really what it's all about. They are upset because nobody wants them. They want black women, but since the black women, it seems as though black women don't want them, then they want to show off and talk about me and my Caucasian girl or my Asian girl or whatever. It's all rooted in they want a woman. Really, probably just anything they can get their hands on. Because in this society, males have been conditioned to be dogs, whoremongers. So they just want to join the whoremongers. They want to be part of the clique. And that's what it's all about. So when you see them finally tell you, oh, I found a girlfriend, then all that stuff they was talking about, black women bashing and whatever, of course, the girlfriend, she's not in that category of the women they was talking about. And their whole demeanor, it changes. Because the bottom line was, I'm upset because I can't get a girlfriend. That's so pathetic. Wow. It's sad, but it's a reality that we have to deal with. These youngsters, they have no, you know, growing up on computers, they don't know how to interact with nobody. And who knows how long, they have a girlfriend this minute, who knows how long that's going to last. But anyway, I'm glad that you finally found yourself a female, somebody that you can be with, and I hope that you're happy even if it's just for a few minutes. You know, it's just sad. You need to find happiness in yourself. You don't need to another person to be happy in yourself. We are always taught in the so-called Black conscious community, love thyself, know thyself. Know yourself, love thyself as an individual, and you won't be having all these problems. You should care less about whether or not these women want you or not. But I want to show you, though, we are made for one another. And we should have this love for one another. But we have been made an unnatural people. So I further bring this or present this commentary to us. In nature, the female is very important. I'm going to say that again. In nature, the female is very important to the male. The female is so important to the male in nature that they will dance all day long. They will holler and scream, croak, and frogs, they croak all day, all night long, whatever. And males will fight one another and they will die. Wow, wow. They will die trying to get the affections of their female. It is not the female that is supposed to attract her to attract her to him, but it's vice versa. It is always the male showing the female how strong I am. I can provide for you. I'm a protector. I want to show you that I'm worthy. I want to show you I'm worthy of your love, your affection. It's not vice versa. Because the males in nature understands it is the female that has the ability to continue the species. It is true that you carry your sperm and you're very important also, but you cannot produce life. You cannot develop life. The only thing that you can do and I can do as men is help. So the Bible is wrong. The Bible is wrong when it talks about that the woman is a helpmate to man. No, the man is a helpmate to the woman. Assist her. So since she's dealing with the production of life, her body has formed in a manner in order for her to take care of that life. And she's depending on the male to assist and help her when their babies, the offspring, the future generation is born. So now in mammals, you see something a little different. A female grizzly bear is almost as strong and big as a male. It is because in nature, some males, especially in mammals, the male does not have nothing to do with the raising and the nurturing of the baby. Matter of fact, there are some cases where male grizzly bears and other males, if you give them a chance, they will eat the cubs, they will eat the babies. But yet and still, during the breeding seasons or whatever, these males fight among one another and they understand the value of their female. The black man in this nation has become an unnatural man. And that's because we have been enslaved. And since we have been enslaved, we've lost that connection to our women, our females, and they have lost that connection to us. That's why it's easy for black men to bash black women. That's why it's easy for black women to bash black men, because we've lost that natural connection. We don't see no value in black women. We don't see the value in black men. But I want to say this to the brothers very quickly before my time expires on this particular form that I'm using right now. In regards to your female, You don't see the black woman as valuable as gold. But let us take a look at how men behave around gold. You go into the earth and you have to mine the gold and the diamonds from up out of the earth. Many people have died trying to get gold. Many people have suffered trying to get diamonds from up out of the earth. Is this true or not? This is what you do for gold. This is what you do for diamonds. But you can't, but that gold and that and those diamonds, they have, it has value, but that gold and those diamonds can't hug you. That gold and those diamonds could not feed you on its breast and make you strong so that you can grow up and take care of yourself. That gold and that diamond can't protect you from hostile forces or support you against hostile forces. Gold and diamonds are cold, while that black woman, you can hug her and put her in your arms. And I don't care how big you are, how tough you think you are, you melt in her arms. Wow, it's wonderful just the thought of it. So when you find that gold and you find those diamonds, it's not pretty. You got dust and dirt and all kinds of trash that's on the gold and the diamonds. What makes it valuable? What makes it valuable is that now once you go into the earth and get that gold and diamonds, then you take the time and you polish and you shine and bring out the brilliance in though in that material, and you cut it and you shape it and put it and mold it in the way that you want it. Then it was already valuable, but now it becomes so beautiful, diamonds and gold. And so it is like the black woman, because of slavery, because of this toilet that we live in, this filth that we live in. You keep complaining about how nasty she is and how vile and profane and how ragged she is, and she's a ratchet, but you don't know how to go to her and clean her up and polish her and shine her. She's already valuable, but she just needs her man to come back and help her become the brilliance, that light, that glow that you see coming from gold and diamonds. Your woman is more valuable than gold. Gold and diamonds can't do nothing for you. But that black woman can see, send your DNA into the future and give you what some may call eternal life. That gold and that silver, it means nothing, because you will go back to the earth, and eventually one day that gold and silver will return to the earth, because future people may not find gold and diamonds valuable. Who knows? But one thing for sure, in life, as we live, in the reality and the nature that we know of, there is no body, no thing more valuable than the female. It's all right to get upset at the black woman. It's all right to be disappointed in everything. But never believe that she's trash. She is the most valuable something that we will ever have. And when we are both in our right state of mind, oh, let the love flow. There's nothing more beautiful when you see a black man, black woman, and their children, everybody is happy together. And that's what we should be striving for. The only thing we have to do now, basically, is remove the dirt and the filth, because there's something beautiful underneath all that garbage. With that said, jot down your comments. Let's talk about it. Until next time, I am Angel Snap Number 7. And just like Don Cornelius say, love, peace. Okay. I want to open up our little brief and short discussion with a question. What do you use to control another person? Well, there are many things that you can use to control another human being. Control your wife. Control your children. Control others. Well, you can deny a person food. That will make them do as you wish, because nobody wants to go hungry. Sometimes a female can control a male because she denies him sexual gratification. So he will do things normally he may not do, but because he's being denied that sexual pleasure, then he can be controlled. Some people can't handle the loss of friendship. Well, I ain't gonna be your friend if you act like that. So you don't want to lose that friendship, so you will submit to their will, and you will voluntarily, because you want to continue that friendship, you will allow them to control you. And the list can go on and on and on, and you already know this, because for many of us, we know that for one reason or another, we are being controlled. However, what do all these things have in common, of which is the number one thing that is used to control the human being, the number one thing that we use to control animals, the number one thing that is used for control, the number one thing that is used for control is fear. Fear of going without food. Fear of not being able to have sexual relations. Fear of losing a friend. Fear of losing a job. Fear of riding the bus. I don't want my car to break down. I don't want to ride the bus. So it is fear. We have fear. And the reason why we have developed fear in nature is to help us avoid danger in order to protect our life. That is the main reason for fear. So when a roach is in the dark and you turn on the light, that roach, because of fear, knowing that you might stomp that roach, try to kill that roach, the roach run as soon as the light comes on, because it knows now that the light is on, its life now could be in danger. So it's a fear. I need to save my life. So when we turn to religious teachings, whether that be Quran or Bible, Torah, or whatever these religious books that you may find in religious teachings, or some may say in religious dogma. And especially we find in Christian teachings, you find that there is a promotion, or they advocate the belief that if you do not submit to their God, if you do not submit to their Jesus, then you have a destiny with a place called hell. Now, mind you, for those of you who do study religious teachings, the first version of hell was not even hot. The first version of hell was cold, because those people saw that death followed when the earth turned cold. Animals stopped reproducing. The whole thing, the whole planet seems to shut down when it turns cold. So the old pictures that you see that represented hell, you would see the colors blue and a lot of white, because that represented wintertime. It was cold. So why did hell turn from cold to hot? It turned from cold to hot because of the popularity of a book. What was that book called? Oh man, what is the name of that book? I should have. Well, I didn't think I was going to be talking about that book, but it was a book, a very popular book, that depicted souls going to this place of torment, this place of not only hellfire, but of torment. And the Catholic Church, the Christian Church, adopted that into their teachings and turned, in fact, there was no hell. They turned what would become hell hot because of the popularity of this book. And I will, maybe before I finish this video, I can remember. It's on the tip of my tongue. But it was because of the popularity of this book. But anyway, going back to Christian teachings about going to hell, I want to tell all my Christian brothers and sisters, and all you who believe in this going to hell thing, I don't fear going to hell. I don't fear going to hell. You are not going to use hell to control me. You're not going to use fear of this punishment of an eternal damnation to control and make me a slave like you have become a slave. I'm not going to be a slave to your God or to a devil. It's simple as that. Going to hell. Exactly what is that, going to hell? Is it really what y'all claim that this place could be? Well, I remember not too long ago, somebody told me that the city of East St. Louis, you can't go to East St. Louis. It's terrible. You'll get shot. You'll get killed. You'll get hurt. That's what I was told. And when I went to East St. Louis, the people there are very friendly. It's no different from any other place that you've been. It's very moderate. It's not fast-paced. There really was nothing. There's murder and rape and all kinds of things everywhere that you go. East St. Louis was no different from any other place. But some people would tell you how bad East St. Louis was. And perhaps maybe it was for them. I went myself and found out that East St. Louis was not that bad at all. I've had very wonderful experience in the city of East St. Louis. Shouts out to East St. Louis, Illinois. I was told not too long ago that you should not put in an application to work at this certain place. Oh, you'll catch hell. You'll catch hell there. It's very, very bad. So eventually I put in an application and I worked at this place. I did not find that it was a hellhole. I did not find all these things that were so bad and terrible. about hell, well, this workplace, it was not as bad as somebody claimed. Now, mind you, East St. Louis and this job is a place that you actually can go and experience yourself. However, in this make-believe place that Christians give us, this place called hell, nobody has been there to say whether it really is a hell or not. But they give to you and try to put fear in you that if you don't obey their God, if you don't believe in their Jesus and whatever, you'll be going to this place of eternal damnation. Fear. Well, I don't fear, so that does not work on me. In fact, what could be worse? What could be worse than this life that we're living right now? Hell possibly could be much better than what we're living right now. In fact, once we die, that's the real fear of death. And so we create heaven and hell so that there is an afterlife. Because we fear death, we don't want to believe that once you die, that's it. We want to continue to live either in heaven or hell or someplace. Lord knows, we don't want to, you just can't just die and just go out of existence. Where were you before you were born? What was happening with you before you was born? So you go to hell, and this Christian believer told me that you'll be a slave for the devil for eternity. Really? And you will be tormented the rest of your existence or whatever. So if I'm going to be a slave for the devil, I asked this person, what kind of work will I do in hell if I want to be the devil's slave? What kind of torment? Once I die, according to you, the spirit leaves the body. So physical fire, heat and cold, none of that can harm me anymore. So if I go to hell and it's hot in hell, what difference do it make? I'm no longer a flesh and blood. I'm now a spirit. Fire and heat can no longer harm me. What kind of work? What kind of work? Describe the work that the devil want me to do. I might like it. Who knows? These are questions that need to be answered. Because hell might be a place we might like. We have to visit it and go to see whether or not we are being tormented. It might be a happy place. But the way that we're taught, it's like it's a bad place when you really don't know. So you're telling me a lie. You're making up something that you don't know nothing about. Who has been there and returned? But no matter what, whether I go to heaven or hell, it makes no difference. I'm not going to be a slave to the devil or to God. You have to kill me again. I'm not going to bow down to, I'll be a runaway slave from the devil, a runaway slave from God. The only way that you can cause me harm is to put me back in a physical body. Then heat, I can be tormented. Tormented to the point where I suffer, but the body don't die. But if I'm a spirit, you can't harm a spirit. So I could care less. Your story about heaven and hell don't scare me. But I would like for us to concentrate on liberating our mind from such teaching and from these races who advocate and put this kind of stuff in our minds, even ancient people. We need to let that stuff go because it's not real. Accept your reality. With that said and done, jot down your comments, share the video. Until next time, love peace and soul. Hello, I'm your soul brother number one, and this is another edition of what I call the Realities Temple on Earth Internet Ministry. And I am Angel Snupnup 7, star of screen, stage, and the ghetto with another rant video. Yes, this is a rant video. I just wanted to get this off my chest, and so I hope that you bear with me, and you may agree and you may not agree. It's not one of those whether I agree or, I mean, we all have our opinions, so I'm not even going, this is not even an issue that we can debate. Well, actually it is. I'm just kidding. Anyway, we have a picture here of my sister, my soul sister, who is not in her right state of mind, with this Caucasian pink person. Now, some of you might call me a hater. Yes, I'm a hater. So if you want to call me jealous, yes, I'm jealous and I'm a hater. Absolutely right. Now, I first learned that Tyra, my soul sister, and should be my wife. Yes, that's right. I'm going to say it. Tara, you should be my wife. I'm going to say it in the public. That's right. So I am jealous and I am a hater, but I have good reason. I want you to hear me out. Everybody hear me out. Now, I first heard about Tara and this pink Caucasian guy on Wendy Williams. And she was talking about how Tara and her boyfriend, this guy here, and they adopted a baby and all that kind of stuff. Pissed me off. Yes, I'm very angry and upset. And the picture, excuse me, I might not be able to talk, but the picture is starting to make me throw up. For real. And I tell you why. And see, this is the thing about it also. Wendy Williams talking about, and also in general, some especially among descendants of slaves born in America having dark skin who are not in their right state of mind, that I call dark Europeans, they promote this interracial relationship stuff like it's cool, it's beautiful, it's a good thing, like it's good. And I'll tell you this, see, it's promoted and it's advocated to put in black people's minds like things have changed, but yet and still our babies are still being shot down in the street. We still suffer housing discrimination, job discrimination, and other evils that have not changed going on 500 years. So, but if Tyra Banks is with a pink guy, now this guy, I think he's from Sweden or somewhere, Norwegian or whatever. Anyway, he's a pink guy. It don't make me no difference. Tara, you ain't got no business being with this guy. You need to be with an African Americanist. That's where you need to be. Now, you keep talking about this interracial relationship stuff, but it wasn't that long ago when a little boy named Emmett Till, he was accused of looking at a Caucasian woman's clothes on a clothesline, and they murdered that young boy. Now all of a sudden, it's the end thing. I guess since they won't murder you, you feel better about getting close to your masa. And that's what it's about. It's about getting close to your masa. You have a feeling, you know, the closer that you can get with Caucasian people, some of these black folks, they feel as though they made it. Just like a dog, I'm not calling us a dog, but you know how it is with your dog, when your dog rub against your leg and you, that dog feels better being close to his masa. And that's how it is with us black folks in this nation. It's not the fact that we really love and really care. It's an unnatural relationship. It's an unnatural relationship that was caused, and we were brought together by slavery. It was not voluntarily. It's not like we were in Somalia or Angola or the Sudan or the Congo, and we came here and we knew, you know, we fell in love with some Europeans. That's not what happened. Our relationship started 500 years ago involuntarily, and not, and many of us have died because we looked at their drawers on a clothesline. You know, back in the day, Tyra, you know, she had a relationship with John Singleton, and a black man, very awakened black man. That basketball player, Chris, whatever. I'm pretty sure she had some other relationships with some Caucasian guys. But I heard Tyra say, out of her own mouth, many times, Tyra said, "I love a chocolate man. Love a dark-skinned man. Tyra, what's wrong with you? Why you end up with this? That's not chocolate. That's not dark skin." Tyra loves black men. I think she does. I don't know. You can tell by the actions, but you know, I'm going to tell you, see, it's very frustrating dealing with black people, dealing with black men. So I understand sometimes how she got caught up in this, but I do know that Tyra does love black men. She said, "I love a chocolate man. A European can't be a chocolate man." Oh man, you just jealous and you a hater. I said that before. Didn't I tell you? Yes, I'm jealous and a hater. Tyra, you need to get your arms away from this guy. You know, that's not where you belong. Tyra said, "I don't want to be a trophy wife." And one of the problems she said that she had with black men is that they want to present her like this trophy wife. Well, unfortunately, soul sister, you are who you are. And no matter who you deal with, you can be viewed like a trophy wife. Right now, you're a trophy girlfriend. Here's a European that probably make $1.50 shooting some pictures. And here he has Tyra Banks, America's Next Top Model, or America's top model, period. You know, you got your arms all wrapped around him. And, you know, all the other Caucasian men, wow, you know, you got that on your arms. And ooh, you was able to pull that. I bet this guy don't have no kind of personality or nothing. Look. Yes, I'm a hater and I'm jealous. Absolutely correct. The sad thing about all this is that Tyra did a DNA on her America's Next Top Model show. And when what she found in her own DNA, that she's African. See, the problem with that you're African, is that African people who were not under slavery, Sister Tyra, I'm gonna say this again. African people who were not under slavery did not chase Europeans. Matter of fact, again, I'm not calling this a dog, but I'm just using a dog for an example, because a dog is an animal that has been domesticated. If the dog was not domesticated, if that dog was in the wild where that dog belongs and not in your house, that dog would not have nothing to do with you. Animals, when they are in their right state of mind, will do their best to avoid you. They are not interested in you. An African and a European are two different people, two different lifestyles. Africans were not interested in Europeans. The only reason why you're interested in that European is because of the unnatural situation that American black people have found ourselves in, which was 300 years of slavery. That's just the bottom line. And so you've fallen in love with your oppressor, with your abuser. And now, since we're able to get so close and Masa have gave us all these different opportunities, but guess what? How do they respond? They respond by killing your sons and daughters in the street. They respond by ignoring your issues that you have, that we have as a people. They don't care. And then they throw pictures like this up in our face, like it's changing slowly, but why is it changing so slowly and surely? Why is it happening slow? Because they don't want change at all. They like the slave-master relationship. He is the superior and you are the inferior. With all your money and fame, he still, because his people sit in a superior position in the world, he still is superior over you. And again, going back to Tara's DNA test, not only did Tara find out that she's African, but she found out that in America, she come from ancestors that were strong. They were very, what some may call, pro-black. So what would your ancestors, what would Tara's ancestors say, who grew up in an outright environment of prejudice and racial hatred, what would they say about their daughter hugged up with a Norwegian? Well, I guess if you got to have a Caucasian on your arm, I think it would be better to have. I'm really sick. Let me. I get ready to throw up. How can it be better? But as far as I know, Norwegians. I don't know if they had anything to do with the slave trade or anything. You know, any type of atrocities against black people. I don't know. The history on that, but I do know for a fact, regardless, he's a European, and he does not have he should not be with, and Tyra should not be with this European. That's just the bottom line. You sound racist. I can sound whatever I want to. Tyra is an American black woman. She comes from the soul people of this nation. And she should be with her own until we can come into our own. She's very valuable to us. She's not valuable to none of you. Tyra, you are not valuable to them. You're just a trophy. The very thing that you said that you don't want to be viewed as, you're nothing but a trophy to them. A conquest. You know, when a gunfighter shoot down so many people, he put a notch on the barrel of his gun for how many people he killed. That's all that it's about. But Tyra wouldn't be involved in this at all if it was not for the unnatural condition that we as soul brothers and sisters in America found ourselves in. And that's because we actually live and interact with the slave master. That's the reason why you have that relationship with your dog. If your dog was wild, that dog would not have nothing to do with you. For what? What can you do for that dog? You are the dog is the dog, and you are who you are. There is no benefit, but there's a benefit. There's no real benefit to Tyra, but there's a benefit to him, because her money, her fame, her resources slide on over to the European side. And he's smiling because he's taking resources and he's taking one of the valuable slaves, so she can't help her own people. She does not have that mindset. I want to say this very quickly, though. I do admire. And I like Tyra. I like the way she stood up for Yaya. I think that was season 3 of American Top Model, when Yaya was expressing her African side. So there is good. I know there's good in Tyra. And maybe she's with this European simply because of frustration. Has nothing to do with prejudice. Has nothing to do with hate. For me, a little bit of jealousy, because Tyra should be with me. But anyway. But, you know, we need to, until black people can learn how to love themselves, Tyra, our black women, black men need to find black women, and black women need to be with black men, or we really don't need to be with nobody at all. Forget all that. You got to love somebody. All the millions of black people in this nation, you know, especially with the resources and influence that you have, you can find a good black man, Tyron. Here is one right here. Telephone number is right there. Give me a call, Tyron. With that. Now, here we go. I met a brother, and during interaction with a customer, and the brother asked me, he looked at me, then he looked at my name, and he was like, "What's up with this? You know, are you a Muslim?" I said, "No." "Are you a Christian?" I said, "No." In fact, I told him, many would call me an atheist, but I'm not an atheist, because an atheist, in some kind of way, I guess they can comprehend what you're talking about when you say or mention God. The only problem is they don't believe in your God. However, for me, I don't acknowledge God. So since I do not acknowledge God, I can neither believe or disbelieve. I have no idea what you're talking about. I've never interacted with your God. I don't know. There's nothing I can say really on the issue about your God. Now, when you introduce me to your God, and I can interact with your God, and maybe we can go out to dinner or something and have a talk, then I will let you know whether or not I believe or disbelieve in your God. Until that time comes, then I do not acknowledge something like that. So the brother was very, very curious. Then he continues to ask me, "Where do we come from?" And I told him, "What difference do it make? I mean, the only thing that you should be concerned about, because we may never know how we come into existence, but what we do know is that we are here. And we have to deal with the life that we've been given, or we can take our life and go right back where we came from, I guess. So either we live or we die. It does not make a big difference arguing and debating over something that we may never, never, ever know. Makes no sense." And I also told him and made very clear, I'm not into make-believe stories about how God created us and all that make-believe fictional stuff that you can't prove. It's just, you know, I'm not into that. So then the brother continues, and this is what our talk is about in the next 7 minutes or so, eight. He asked me about, "Well, if you don't care about where we come from, what is our destiny? What is our destiny as black peoples, soul brothers and sisters on this planet?" Now, you have three functions. Well, it's not a function. You have three points that we can make in speaking about our destiny. One point is, speaking of destiny, is that somebody else, another person, maybe your God, somebody is controlling your destiny. Many of us, we raise chickens, and that chicken lay an egg. We already have decided the destiny of the chicken and the egg. And the destiny is just the planning of the future for that particular life. So you have planned for the future for this particular life, that you will use the egg for your cake, and you have planned to have fried chicken on Sunday. So you have already written the destiny, the plan for that chicken. Now the thing about this is, just because that you have written out the life plan for this chicken doesn't necessarily mean that's what's going to happen, because one day you go out and the chicken has escaped and took off. So now the chicken has taken its destiny out of your control into its own control by escaping your control. And now we don't know what the chicken's destiny might be, but one thing for sure, you're not going to have chicken on Sunday, and you're not going to have those eggs for your cake. So, but when your life is in the hands of somebody else, your destiny, the plans for your life, is in the hands of others. When we are babies, little infants, and we can't take care of ourselves, our destiny is in the hands of our parents. We are in the control, our life is in the control of others. The next point I've already explained, giving the example of the chicken, is when you take control of your destiny, and your destiny is only the planning of your life, where you want to go, what you want to do with your life. That's all destiny is. And then, regardless to whether your life is in the hands of another person, or whether that your life is in the hands of yourself, there are forces outside of your control that might change your destiny. Whenever there is a hurricane or an earthquake or a flood or any natural disaster or something outside of yourself, a car accident, there are things that can change your destiny. I remember in Chicago, there was a young man, and he played basketball very well, and he was on his way to college, and people thought he was going to end up in the NBA, and that was his destiny. That was the plan for his life. But before he could even graduate high school good, he was shot down on the streets of Chicago. I believe that's where he was living, this particular young man. He was a resident of Chicago. So at 17 or 18 years old, his destiny was to end up at 17 or 18 years old in the morgue. So all those plans of going to college and going to the NBA, all that was null and void, because there was something that was outside of his control. And maybe it was something, some of the things was in his control, but he did not heed the warning. Then, see, that's what's wrong with the descendants of slaves born in America having dark skin, the people I call soul brothers and sisters, or black people. We don't heed warnings. We don't respond to things that could change our destiny. We continue to do the same things, expecting a different result. And my friends, we all know that is called insanity. Also, in the planning of your destiny, there should be a purpose. The purpose of that young man to go to college and to the NBA was to make a better life for himself and his family. So there must be a purpose. However, in order to maintain or create a beneficial destiny for you or us as a people, A liberated mind must be created that can determine that purpose and that goal. But at this time, since we know, we don't know about having a free mind, then the only thing that the current mindset of black people in this nation have is that one of a slave. So our destiny and our purpose is for the benefit of somebody else. And if it is not for Caucasian people, then we happily dedicate our life to some god or some alien, something that we want to submit to and worship. So we have a slave mentality. A slave mind can only create slavery. And the only thing black people in this nation wants to do is just exchange one slave master for another, whether it's going from this Caucasian person to another, or sharing, having yourself two masters. One is the Caucasian people, and the other one is this mysterious God person that y'all love, or alien, or whatever. So that is destiny. Destiny is simply, is nothing but the planning of one's life. The purpose, setting a purpose and goal for that life. No more, no less. But if your mind is not liberated and you don't think as a free person, then the only thing we will continue to do is act like slaves. With that said, jot down your comments. Until next time, love, peace, and soul.